Hello and welcome to In the Mix with yours truly, Jeannie Ortega. I'm coming to you from the Sunshine State, Orlando, Florida. It's my honor to be your host today on TV and Salsa. Thank you, Matt and Lori Crouch, as well as Reverend Samuel Rodriguez, for an opportunity to boast on God. With this show, it's my heart to highlight people in music, movies, media, and ministry that are doing things for the kingdom of God. The Bible says every good and perfect gift comes from heaven. Well, it also says that God has given a gift to each and every one of us to share with each other as good stewards of His amazing grace. And today, this show, oh my gosh, I have the privilege to introduce you to some world changers that are doing just that. It's a panel of culture shifters who are testifying about their individual journeys to freedom. And in this show, we're specifically talking about freedom from homosexuality, which I know is a controversial, taboo topic in this day and age, but there are people that have a voice that are testifying that God does redeem, and He does change, and He redirects, and He takes brokenness, and He gives you beauty. So everybody, I want to introduce you to my panel here. Far over there on that side is Edward. Here's Kim, Angel, and Luis. Thank you guys for being on TBN Salsa.
Thank you for having us.
You know, I got the privilege to chat with two of you in an earlier episode, and it was just incredible. The feedback, the power that we felt after the episode. I mean, even after we shot the episode, we were just, whoa. We knew that something had shifted and that God was working. And I wanted to sit down and chat with some of you, because since then I've received mail and messages and things, and there's other people in my life that love me, and I know I have battled with homosexuality or their sexuality and identity. So this is an important topic.
Yeah.
So I want to start, I want you all to share a brief testimony. So Edward, I'm going to start with you. I'm putting you on the hot seat, sorry. Brief testimony, and then Kim, after you, we'll part, because I want to just introduce these two. They have a specific, unique tie to each other. Go ahead, Adam.
Okay, so, yes. My mom had me when she was 15 years old.
Wow.
And my dad was in and out of our life. He was abusive to my mom, and it was just a lot of brokenness.
Mm-hmm.
And with a broken foundation, you left to live a broken life, and it led me to try to figure out my sexuality. It led me into a whole lot of different things, trying to figure out my sexuality. And growing up without the influence of my father, it left me questionable. I didn't have the mannerisms that a stereotypical guy would necessarily have. So people were always asking, are you gay, or saying I was gay, or just different things like that. So I grew up with that mindset, confused, trying to figure things out, broken, didn't have my dad. My mom had him when she was 15, so homosexuality was like open arms.
Yeah.
And I ran into it, and when I got into a lifestyle, I totally, by the age I was about 20, not even 20, by the age I was like 18, I totally was just invested in a lifestyle, got into drugs, alcohol. I was an exotic dancer for some time and just kind of very promiscuous, you know, living that lifestyle. But then I radically found a love that totally transformed my life and my heart and my mind. And now everything I do is for Jesus.
Wow. Well, we'll pause there, because we're going to come back to the Jesus part. Kim, tell us about you.
Yeah, so I grew up in San Diego. Parents together, two older brothers. I think most people would look at my life and say that I had it quote unquote perfect.
Wow.
Grew up in the church, and in high school decided that I was gonna get a little risky.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up kissing my best friend, which was a girl.
Mm-hmm.
And that opened something in me.
Mm-hmm.
And I became hungry. I fed a desire that I really did have.
Wow.
But once I had fed it, I found that it wasn't gonna go away.
Mm.
And so, but I hid it for a long time.
Mm.
And I didn't want my family to know. I didn't want anybody to know. So I lived kind of just sneaking off and doing things behind everybody's back.
Yeah.
And fast forward, ended up getting married to a man. But that said, I'm never gonna do it again. I want what you have for me, God. And I met this amazing man, got married. Long story, we moved to Africa and came back, and I cheated on him. With a married woman.
Wow.
And that led into divorce and then a lifestyle of dating women for years, and had a radical encounter with God. I prayed that God would take the feelings and desires I had, but I surrendered it. I said, God, take these. I give these to you, and show me that you have better. And from that day forward, by his grace, his mercy, I've been walking in his freedom, his joy. Yes. Still have, regular life, wow. But it's been just an
extreme blessing.
How long
was that? How long has it been?
That was 4 years ago.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. All right, we'll park here because I do want to tell you about these two gentlemen, and I'm coming from the back end of it, but I want you to introduce your early life as well. But on June 12, 2016, a gunman opened fire in a gay nightclub, killing 49 people. And that was right here in Orlando, Florida, Pulse Gay Nightclub. And I remember being home with my husband and watching that and just being chilled to the core. God, what is happening? And little did I know that 2 years later, I'd be sitting here with two Pulse survivors. So thank you guys for being on the program.
Of course.
Angel, I know you were a victim of some of those bullets, correct?
Yes, correct.
So you're definitely a living miracle, both of you. Tell us a little bit about your background, Angel.
Yes, I actually grew up in church. I was in church my whole life. Even though I had those thoughts and those feelings and desires in me, I didn't act upon it. Mm-hmm. Until I was 18 years old, a lot happened in my family. My dad cheated on my mom with my best friend, and I turned into a rebel. Mm-hmm. And I took that time. I was like, wow. I'm done. I left my home, and I started to live the life of homosexuality. And I was gone from God's will for 8 years.
Wow.
And as the years passed by, it got worse and worse. Not only was I consumed in homosexuality, I was an alcoholic, and I was addicted to cocaine as well.
Wow.
And in 2016, I was already fed up with it all. I grew up being a worshiper in God's path, and I loved being with God, and I missed it.
Mm.
And I started praying to God, God, do something. Do your will. I want to come back to you. I told my mother, because my mom is a prayer warrior. My mom, pray. I know that a mother's prayer is one of the strongest prayers. Do something. And I prayed to God for months before June. And I told him, do whatever you have to do. Mm. I don't care what it is.
Oh, Jesus.
And June came, and the shooting happened. And I would never think that was going to be what was going to happen to just change my life. Mm. Receiving shots, I thought I was shot 3 times. I was shot 6 times. And, life after that was, it was hard because it's a long process. But through that process, I learned to stop battling with God and telling him, Lord, why am I like this? And until there was a turning point, and I said, you know what, Lord, you deal with that. I'm going to deal with just learning how to have a relationship with you, Lord. And the moment I did that, I just learned what true happiness was. Mm. I learned what true peace was and what true love was.
Wow.
And for the rest of my life, I'm going to be with that because I wouldn't trade that for the world.
Amazing. You're definitely a miracle. You were shot 6 times.
6 times.
And you're only a little limp. He only has a little tiny limp.
And the name of Jesus, this is going to go away.
Amen. Exactly.
Yes.
And that's what I was saying. It's just a little limp right now, but I know it's going to be gone.
Yes.
And you're really, that's it. Incredible.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
Luis, yes. Sorry. He called me Jenny off camera. I said, I'm going to call you Luis. My bad.
You got me.
Luis, tell us.
So I was a pastor's, I am a pastor's kid.
Wow.
And they say that those are the worst. So I grew up in the church. My father was also in the military. So when it came to the topic of homosexuality, I grew up in a culture where that was not spoke about. The only thing they told you was to abstain from sex.
Mm.
That's it. You don't talk about anything else. You just don't do it.
Wow.
So growing up in religion and legalism, I learned how to lie, how to deceit, and so much many other things that I kept inside because I was so scared of talking about it with someone.
Yeah.
And when my dad did find things like pornography or whatever, I would get so much backlash and hate on it that it kind of scared me to stay quiet.
Mm.
Growing up with that, I thought that joining the army would take it away, it put me back into the closet, but I was struggling. I was struggling. And I would go to churches to try to I'd say, okay, let me try another church maybe or something.
Mm.
But I was looked at as the guinea pig. you know? And then they wanted me to come to Christ, and then a couple of weeks later, I had to talk a certain way, walk a certain way, and then a week after that, they would tell me that salvation looks like marriage, so I need to get married.
Oh,
instead
God.
Of the evidence of that being the fruits of the Spirit, they wanted me to be married, so I had to hide all these things. In that, years later, I get out the military and I end up in Orlando, Florida. I've always had a heart for Orlando. Something was always pulling me to this state. Mm. So I moved over here with a backpack. I moved in with a cousin. And from that, 5 years later, you know, I'm still here. And in that, I ended up at Orlando Pulse that night. And I actually knew Angel. We knew each other. We were good friends then.
Oh, so you knew each other prior.
Yeah, so we actually was at a party. Before that, and I remember him telling me, are you going? And I was like, yeah, I'm going.
To Pulse.
Right, and that was our last conversation that we had. We ended up at Pulse Nightclub where we lost a lot of friends, and by the grace of God, I was able to make it out of there still in pain and hurting because
I was trampled.
You
still ended up in the hospital.
And I still ended up in the hospital. And not only just through that, but you'd think that from that you just learned your lesson. And after that, like a couple months later, I found out that I'm HIV positive. Mm-hmm. So in that time is when God just, I was just like, I can't no more. Because I feel that if I keep living in sin, and not just homosexuality, because that's just one part.
Yeah, there was other things.
And there was other things that I needed to clean up, and it was a process, and it was a praying mother as well, you know, that never compromised, but believed that I was what the Bible and what God said I was.
That's incredible. Yeah. It's amazing to hear all of your journeys in this way. I just, I'm like, wow, God, you know, and then to me, it seems, it's also, it speaks to how God reaches us all in different ways, you know. For some of us, we're a little more stubborn than the others, and, you know, and it'll take a dramatic experience, and you know, I'm a part of that stubborn crew, so I get it, you know, where it's like, oh, man, I could have, like, why couldn't I have got here before? Well, you wouldn't listen, and I'm like, oh, okay. But I do want to share about the moment that you guys decided to give in to the desire of homosexuality, right? I know we live in a culture where as more and more now every day it's catered to freedom has a different meaning than what freedom in the Bible is, right? So freedom is do whatever makes you feel good in this day and age, right? So that can be anything. Like, if I'm looking to get high, then I can do something that'll make me feel high because I'm free to do it. But what we do know, right, about everything is that just because you can do everything doesn't mean you should do everything. And that's scriptural. There's a Bible that actually says that. And we all know that everything we do comes with a cost, a price. But I wanted to talk to you, and whoever wants to jump in can, about that spirit of enticement that's out there in the world that is luring. You know, I had a little cousin recently, and she's since transitioned back, but she was like, I think I'm going to try to be gay for a little bit. And she's 16, and I'm like, but you've always liked boys. Like, what happened? You know, and it's something that's out there that's enticing. So what would you say?
I know for me, it was, I've always had, like, in my spirit, I know now it was the Holy Spirit, but this hunger, this desire for a challenge to be a leader. And so for me in high school, it was like, okay, well, I dated that guy. I got, you know, there was all these different challenges, like check, check, check. And I really did have this desire. And it was that lure of doing what you're not supposed to.
I heard you say that in your testimony, which I think is very important, right? Because there's another popular saying, born this way, right? Yeah. Like, I was born a lot of ways, you know what I mean? Like,
I was born hungry.
Yeah. Well, it's just, we all have... But, like, even speaking spiritually, like, we all have different hungers.
Absolutely.
Than not everything. Like, you know, when somebody cuts you off in traffic, you want to punch them in the face. Or at least you do if you're from Brooklyn and you're me. Well, it's true. So it's just, like, I understand the desire of being born a certain way, right, with these desires. But what, like, now somebody, you said you've always had that in you. Speak to that. But what does that mean to somebody that wants to use that as a... offense.
Yeah, so for me, it was a real desire. You know, I'm in a position where I was never abused. I have no reason to say that this is why I feel that way. This is something that I do remember, even when I was a little girl, kind of feeling. And so for me, but again, I have like you said, I have a lot of desires. If I chose to walk every one of those out, good Lord, help the world, not just my life, but I mean, honestly. Yeah. And so, but I was living that way because the moment I fulfilled that desire, it was, okay, well, I'm going to fulfill this one too, and this one, and this one. Mm. And then it's just this.
It opens up a flood.
Oh, I turned into someone I never knew.
Wow. Angel, I want to ask you about, I know you were living in the lifestyle for a while, right?
Yes.
And I'm pretty sure now being on this side of things where you guys are speaking up about it, you get the challenge. That's a lie. I don't believe that. Mm. How do you respond to that? How do you respond to now you said, God, I still have those struggles, but I'm not going to deal with that. I'm working on this. How do you encourage or just testify of that place, because there's a lot of people who will use, but I still feel the attraction or whatever it is. Like, you know, for me, it wasn't girls, but it was guys, right? Mm-hmm. So the lust is still lust.
Yes.
So, you know, I know that I have to die to that as well. But talk to us from somebody who's had that lifestyle of homosexuality. And
of course, yes. I was actually preaching about this last week, and I spoke to Lewis about it as well, and I was telling him, our lives is just like Jesus' path. It was beautiful in the beginning. And then persecution came. And then people spat on him. People talked evil against him. And then he fell down. He had to pick up his cross, get back up, and continue moving forward.
Yeah.
You know, I tell people, it's, you know, it's like me having my cross right there. Mm. You know, knowing that desire is there. I don't want anymore. But it's there, I just gotta continue moving forward.
Yeah.
You know, and I tell people, it's crazy when I say this, but you know, don't be ashamed of the cross that you have. Because because of that cross, I am where I am today.
Wow.
Because of that cross, I am victorious today. Mm. Because of that cross, I'm doing so many things in God's will, and doors are opening because of I have that cross. Mm. And being vocal about it, you know, I love saying this. I have posted this. There are so many souls that are waiting for you to do what God has called you to do. Yeah. So when they see that cross that you're carrying, they're like, oh my God, I had that cross too. And it's possible to move forward.
And even you guys are all an example of that, because of you sharing your own journeys, you came together.
Yes.
Like you flew down to DC when they did their march for freedom of homosexuality. You're like, there are other people like me who have found this freedom.
That is that encouragement. You know, but they say, right, that's scripture, the testimony. Our testimony is prophecy into someone else's life.
Amen.
It's a family.
Yeah.
We're all family.
Mm-hmm. Edward, I wanted to ask you, and last time you were on, we talked about just, you know, being fashionable and using whatever God has still gifted you to, you know, and not feeling like because I'm fashionable or I have style, like I'm gay. Talk to us a little about this journey now where you know, as the Holy Spirit is leading you, because he stripped you. You were, I've seen pictures of you like in full makeup and wigs. Yeah. Like, so talk to us about that transition of like, what do you say? Like, all right, Holy Spirit, what do I do that's artistic liberty? What did I do that was not of you? How's that process?
I mean, my answer, I'll start with this. What you don't do is what happened to me was I was in the ministry for some time, and I always had my own sense of style from birth. I literally would not go to school if I did not like what I was wearing. I would call my mom, like, I'm not wearing this to school, okay? Because this does not represent me. So I've always had my own sense of style. I always wanted to do my mom's hair, my cousins, my sisters. I was like, okay, let me do this. So I've always had a knack or a natural talent, a gift from God to be fashionable, to do style, to do makeup. I never went to school, never had training. I have went since then. But in the beginning, I never went to school. I never had training. It was just something I naturally had. And then when I went to a ministry, I came out of the lifestyle, but I still had flair, I still had style, I still had a little pizzazz, you know, a little something more than other people in a sense. And so they were like, you can't dress like that. You can't do this, you can't do that. And so I had got to a really low place where I literally would sit in my room and cry in front of my closet because I didn't know what to do, I didn't know what to wear. I was like, what do I have to change and what don't I have to change? And it was like in that moment, God said, follow me, listen to me. Listen to what I'm telling you. Yeah. I gave you these gifts because I was literally going to forfeit my gifts of doing hair, literally going to change the way I dressed. I was becoming like trying to be something I wasn't.
Yeah.
And so I had to really get to a place where I was like, okay, God, you can take what you want, but what is me? And I would go shopping and I would like feel a sense, like a real like sense from God, the Holy Spirit. And I'd be like, all right, now can I buy this shirt?
That's good.
And he'd be like, yeah, buy the shirt. Like, I had to get confident and like, this is who I am. You, just because you're fashionable, just because you have style, just because you are entertaining, just because your personality is not somber, you're not macho, you're not, that doesn't mean you're not a man. That doesn't mean you're not a woman if you dress more athletic. Yeah. That's just who you are.
Exactly.
God gave us all individual gifts. We all have different fingerprints. None of our fingerprints will match. You are your own person.
Yeah, everybody's
unique.
Which is what I love about what you're saying is that you know that God has called you to reach a people.
Yeah.
And when you go and you conform and you change, contrary to what the Spirit is leading to you, leading you to do, that's what you do. You forfeit those people that He has for you to reach.
Yeah.
And I love that. That's super powerful.
Yeah.
Luis, these marches, right? And this is how I heard about you guys and what you're doing. You started a march for freedom in Washington, D.C., was that last year now? I don't even know.
Yeah, that was
this year.
Oh, it was this year. Okay, the beginning of this year. But see how God has brought you. Tell us about these marches. Now you have another one scheduled in LA. You're having one for Orlando.
Yeah.
And what are these marches? What are you doing? What's the message?
Well, I definitely want to give the honor to Jeffrey McCall. He is the founder of the Freedom Marches. Mm-hmm. And what we've been doing is we've been going around different cities and just sharing our stories of hope and transformation in Jesus.
All right, last thing. What do you say, each one of you, I want to hear from you very quickly. Mm-hmm. Somebody's going to watch this and say, they're lying. Yeah. What do you say?
I won't try to defend myself because I would leave that up to God, and I would just honestly keep living my life and walking this out. Because when I look in the mirror, I know I'm not the same person that I used to be.
Hallelujah.
Like, I used to have a whole different name. My name was Remy. My name is now Edward Byrd. Hi, woo! Nice to meet you. So I don't really even pay attention to that because people do say that, you know?
Yeah,
but I know who I am, and I'm living it out, and people will see the evidence and the fruit of my walk. And that's what they'll know, that there's a change. Yeah. You can bite this fruit, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Amen.
How about you, Kim?
Amen. I would say the same thing. What God has given me, no one else can steal. So to me, whether there's people that say it's not real, this isn't real, this isn't true, Kim, you're just suppressing it, you're hiding it, you're miserable, call me. Come talk to me. Yeah. You're going to see. Just come hang out with me. Yeah. Follow me for a week.
Wow.
Somebody can't fake that for a week.
Yeah.
And even if so, move next to me. Be my neighbor. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, but that's why I even have the ministry I have, is because they need to see it's real.
Yeah.
It's
incredible.
Real.
Yeah, I agree. A big thing is people will see the fruits that God is giving through you. A lot of survivors actually have reached out to me and they're like, Angel, how are you so happy and peaceful after what you went through?
Impulse.
How are you not fighting with God about you being homosexual, about wanting to be a gay Christian, not having nightmares? I'm like, it's Jesus. I turned to Jesus and He turned my life over and I am happy with Him.
Yeah.
And showing your fruits, that's contagious because they're like, okay, I want that.
Yeah.
I want that. I want to be just like that. I want to smile like Angel smiling. I want to feel that love that Angel has.
And worshiping. You know, with, I've been seeing you little worship videos.
My worship videos. And I believe, you know, don't let the atmosphere transform you. You transform the atmosphere. Yes. You show the world what you are.
Yes.
And that will show everything.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Well, one thing is that my identity lies in above, you know? Yeah. I can't sit here and just, we've grown into a society where we just, we're offended and we dictate what people say about who we are. Mm-hmm. But I find more that the more I get in His presence, that's where my identity lies. So I'm not worried about my neighbors telling me who I am. I know who I am through Christ Jesus. So I think we just have to get into that presence of God where you will find your identity and nothing else will matter.
I think you hit it right on the head right there. Identity is everything. Yeah. This is one issue, homosexuality. Mm-hmm. There are things that we all struggle with. There are things that come and tell us that we're this or we're that, and we want to give into that if we're not sure of what our identity is in Jesus Christ. And what I do know is he has a purpose for us all. Amen. And as you see right here, he is shifting culture, Amen. Using yes. people, just Amen. Willing to share the truth of what Jesus has done in their life. So now we're going to end with that, our incredible brother Edward with his song about his story, his testimony, ran into you.
I've been giving myself away. I've been giving myself away.